Okay. So what is the IBP? Essentially, the IBP is a system where we're trying to aggregate information on biodiversity and make it available freely to anyone who wants to access biodiversity information. All the data on IBP is available under Creative Commons license, which means you can give credit, you have to give credits to whoever has uploaded the content. But essentially, under these various Creative Commons licenses, it's freely available for further use. So just to go to the background of how IBP came about, in 2005, when AIDV set up its ecology informatics division, it was felt that there's a need for some medium to put out information on biodiversity. And as a result of that, the National Knowledge Commission was approached with a proposal to set up the India Biodiversity Portal to put out biodiversity information. And at that time, it was under a consortium of institutions that this happened. Mostly, you can see a few of the logos of institutions that were involved. And in October 2007, AIDV presented a discussion paper on building the India Biodiversity Portal. And in 2008, work on the India Biodiversity Portal began. And at that time, it was just a map-based interface where all information was put onto a map and put out. So very basic system of putting out information. In 2009, so from 2008 to 2009, IBP was going on in a map mode. There's not much participatory interfaces. But in 2009, the Critical Ecosystems Partnership Fund did a call for putting out an information sharing system on the Western Ghats. And Strand Life Sciences and the French Institute of Pondicherry did a joint bid for this and got it. And as a result of which, we started working on the Western Ghats portal. But essentially, we're reusing components of the former India Biodiversity Portal, and that's as we were working on the Western Ghats portal, it essentially built components of the India Biodiversity Portal as you see today. In 2009, we came out with the species module, which aggregates information, descriptive information on species, and in early 2012, we created the observation interface, which is the citizen science module on IBP. End 2012, we put out user groups, and mid 2013, documents module. We also have discussion modules, etc. And so, currently, IBP is run as a consortium of institutions. We have 19 partners. You can see the logos of the partners here. We sort of divide the work under software development, content creation, data curation, and outreach and campaigning. And we try and involve these institutions every time there is something to be done. But essentially, there are three institutions which comprise the core group of the India Biodiversity Portal, which is AIDV, Strand Life Sciences, and the French Institute. And the daily activity of these are done by members in these three core institutions. So here we have Strand Life Sciences, we have two developers, Sandeep and Shravanti, Dr. Prabhakar and myself, who work at Strand Life Sciences, essentially with software development, but also share data curation and campaigning responsibilities. At the French Institute, Dr. Ramesh, Balu, Karthik and Satish, who are developers. Are they here? Are developers here? Karthik is there. So just add up Karthik. Karthik has essentially been involved in the mobile app development, etc. The rest of the developers have not yet come. Thanks. And from AIDV, we have Dr. Ganeshan, Sachin, and Rohit, who you would have met right outside. Sachin works from AIDV here, and Rohit works from Sikkim, the AIDV office in Sikkim, where he's running the Northeast Biodiversity Portal activities. So essentially, we have modules on India Biodiversity Portal, where we've broken down information into observations, which are citizen science uploads, species pages, map layers, documents, and some collection of curated lists. And the unique thing about IBP is that you can put in data anywhere, but if it has a common access of a species and a location, we try and bring it together and aggregate this information under a species name. So all this information is sort of gelling in under a species. We are concentrating a lot on building distribution information on species, but we collect other information such as habitat ecology, temporal information, etc. Now, I'll just briefly go on to what are the features and enhancements that have happened since the last community meet in December 2013 in Trishur. So, if you're not familiar with the existing features, we can catch up on that later. You can feel free to contact me and I can help you through these features. So, essentially, last year we had a document module where anybody could upload documents onto the portal. And these documents are essentially PDF files. So, it could be anything like a report, research paper, etc. And so, last year we could only upload a PDF and leave it as such. There was no connection with the rest, interaction with the rest of IBP. But what we've done now is we built a functionality where every time somebody uploads a PDF file, IBP will scan the entire content of the PDF document. It will extract the scientific names from the document, and if we have a species page for this document, it will place a link from the document. You can see some of the names there are in black and some in blue. The ones in blue are the ones that have species pages. So it will automatically link it back to the species page. And if you go to the species page itself, you will see that there's a link back to the document in the species page. So now we have an intelligent system that is trying to aggregate content under a species. So I think this has a lot of potential. We've been discussing with the Journal of Threatened Taxa how we can aggregate all publications from JOTT into IBP. And so I think that will be a fantastic thing to do. Other historical data, other things like Journal of BNHS, we need to explore possibilities and see how we can bring stuff and sort of aggregate content under a species page. We also have a discussion module which is not so active as we like it to be, but I think this is a useful medium to communicate for users to communicate and discuss biodiversity. So we've just enhanced it from what it was there earlier, made it better. You can now tag people if there's a user, just like you do on Facebook. If they're a user, you can tag them and bring them into the conversation, ask them questions, get people to reply, etc. We'd like to see more people adopt this and use it. And hopefully sometime in the future, we can even think of things like text mining. If there's real biodiversity information here, there's bits of knowledge being shared, how do we try and aggregate bits of these and pull it into species pages, etc. Also, once we have started a discussion, the group moderators can announce that discussion. So if we have an event and you start a discussion on an event, you can say, I'm doing this this event, and I'd like to broadcast this message to all users of that particular group. And so this is an example of an announcement that was done for the mapping the Malwa tree toad by Dr. Gurraja, where we try to map the distribution of the Malwa tree toad. And this is the email digest that goes out to all users of the Frog Watch group. You know, all of you can download observations on the portal without restriction. But what we also have is the download of a species list. What is if you go to the observation interface, you can query and generate a list of observations for, say, a particular area. Or you can say, I want observations from a particular taxon group. I want only butterflies, or I want only turtles, for instance. And it will generate a list of observations known to the portal. And it will automatically calculate what are the unique species in that list, essentially a species list. And how many observations are there in that list that you have generated. And this can now be downloaded with a link to its species page so that you can take it and do whatever it is that you wish to do for further analysis. So I think this is a very important system for people who are trying to retrieve content to query and retrieve what information is there on the portal. We will further build in mechanisms to query and get better results from the data that the portal has. And it becomes more important as the data is growing. Something else we've been working on, names on the portal. If you're not into taxonomy, and if you're not into biodiversity informatics, you won't realize how complex the world of naming is. Because a species name is never just really one. It can be synonymized, it can be merged. A single species can have multiple species names, or depending on the authority, who published it, who revised it, etc. And this has been causing a lot of confusion on the portal. We're dealing with all the species groups across the spectrum, right from fungi to mammals. And we need a well-defined system where we can organize content and not just put it under a name and leave it there. So essentially the problem has come because India does not have a single species list, a defined species list that's updated year on year, and somebody who can say this is the species list of India. So what we've done is we've gone to these international databases that have references to Indian species names and downloaded these names and then put it into our database. Now there are obvious problems with these with this approach. This is just an example of the family Fabaceae. If you go to various websites and look at what the classification for Fabaceae is, you'll come across various classifications. Some which say it's Fabaceae, some which don't even call it Fabaceae, it's leguminous. Some say it starts from cellular organisms and then works its way down to planting. Some which introduce new levels which are not there in any of the other systems, etc. So we need to come up with a system that can organize all this information. We need to be able to take in information from different sources, but sort of standardize it. And how do we do this? So again, if you check out Wikipedia, which is obviously when you have a doubt, you search the internet, and the first thing that comes up is Wikipedia. And here it says the Fabaceae, Leguminaceae, or Papilionaceae. So it's adding more confusion. What is it? And if you check the reference, this is from the International Code of Nomenclature for Algae, for Fungi and Plants, and it says Leguminaceae is accepted, Fabaceae is also accepted as an alternative name. So where do we go? How do we reference content? Under Fabaceae, Leguminaceae, Papilionaceae? I don't know. So this is an obvious problem then which we had to circumvent. And the solution to doing this is to find an accepted name, define an accepted name that the system is using, and put everything else as a synonym of that accepted name. Or if it's a common name, put it as a common name of this accepted name. Luckily for us, we found, this is a huge initiative. We're dealing with 50,000 names just as of now. But as we go ahead, the number of names that are coming in will increase. So we can't do this because even if we have the help of one or two taxonomists, what do we do for other divisions that are obscure, like Brachyolmintids, I don't know, some of these which don't count usually, which we don't have experts for. So luckily there is a service called the Catalog of Life, which sort of does exactly this. It takes every name year on year from different sources, tries to do a taxonomic exercise where they put it under an accepted name and say this is a synonym of this accepted name, give it a status, give it a consensus hierarchy, that is seven levels of hierarchy, a taxonomic hierarchy, and provide this as a service, as a free service that other people can use. It has over 158,000 names. And so we can use this. So what we've done, and this is a service that's used by many global biodiversity information sites such as GBIF, IUCN, Lightforce, etc. So what we've done is we've taken these names and referenced it on Catalog of Life and got out the status from Catalog of Life and essentially replicated that with the hierarchy as the IBP hierarchy. Now we have a backbone on which to reference any name that comes in. And that's what we've done so far. And so we've got a unified system with a name, with a status, either accepted name or a synonym or a common name. And if it's a synonym, what accepted name does it fit under? And a hierarchy that fits in on some standard lines so that we don't have to divert too much, we won't have data being divided between synonyms and accepted names. So all content will be aggregated under accepted names. And what we've done is we built a curation interface. So as you can see here, we've got out of 72,000 names, we've got 59,000 names that have been matched to Catalog of Life. But 12,000 names don't have a match. What do we do with this 12,000 names? If I was a taxonomist who was looking into a particular species, maybe I could take a decision on this. But the truth is that IBP is a participatory system where we need the involvement of taxonomists across the board. So what we want is the taxonomists should come and take a look at these 12,000 names and say, is this an accepted name? Is this a synonym? Can we put it under an accepted name? Is this a wrong name? Can we delete it? Can we merge it with something else, etc. And so for this, we provide an interface where when a name comes into a system, it will automatically check on CML whether the system exists. It will download details from catalog of life and then put it into what's called a working list. And this is an automated process. And if you don't find a match on catalog of life, then it goes into what's called a raw list. And this raw list is open for the curators or taxon curators who participate on the portal to come look, use some of the features such as cross-referencing against standard databases, and then move it into the working list with that standard hierarchy and a status, whether it's accepting name or synonym. We also have the functionality of taxon editors. If you are a taxon editor who is looking at a species group in its entirety, say dung beetles or grasshoppers or butterflies, you can provide a list of species under that group which exists in India, which is confirmed, and we can move it into a clean list using the hierarchy that the taxon editor provides. And instead of using the catalog of life hierarchy, we will refer to this hierarchy as the existing hierarchy for IBP. And so if you get people providing such lists, you can go to this this name curation interface and you can just download a list of names in the clean list, which we hope will one day, hopefully in the near future, become a species list for India. So this is the interface of the taxon curation interface. It is still in beta stage. We're still testing it out. It's incredibly complex what happens to names and the changes need to happen. So we're still fine-tuning it. But this is essentially what it is. You can see there's a taxon selector. You can select any level of the taxon and get a list of names, either in the raw list, the working list, or the clean list. If you select any name in either of these lists, it will populate the down panel with its attributes. You can see that there's a hierarchy there. There are 11 levels, but out of it, 7 are compulsory levels for any information that you provide. It has a name. It's extracted the authority of the name, because that's essentially what we use to distinguish two scientific names which are similar. It has a status, rank, the source from which it was downloaded, the ID, etc. And also a list of synonyms under that name. You can also switch to the tab and common names tab and fill in the common names tab. So hopefully this will start with the participation of taxonomists. This will will make a big change to the way we handle names and content on the portal. And this is an incredibly complicated system, so we need to work much more before we can fine-tune this. So once we've got this working, where IBP has a standardized taxonomy, a certain number of levels which are compulsory for all species names, we can do things like this. We can put our taxon browser. So we can see this taxon browser here, which has been built using this new IBP taxonomic hierarchy. And so now we can click on any level, say in any module, and fish out content that has been identified as that particular taxon. So for instance, now I clicked on Hemiptera and brought out all these species pages for Hemiptera. We also give a small taxonomic summary of how many species names there are, out of which how many accepted names, how many synonyms, and how many are intraspecies. And this is only possible because of this exercise of doing this, revamping this name list. We also now put in breadcrumbs, what the developers call as breadcrumbs, on top of each page, so that you can navigate within a page. If you're on the common kingfisher page, you can go and click on the genus and fish out all content for that genus under that family, etc. Now we've built in this complicated mechanism into the way we actually handle new species names. So if you're contributing a new name, it will check. And this time we need to aggregate new species names with an author, with an authority. It will check if this species name exists on the portal. If it does exist, it will reuse the existing ID and it will check if there's a species page. If it doesn't have a species page, it will create that species page. If content does not exist on IBP, if that particular name does not exist on IBP, it will check the catalog of life, retrieve details from catalog of life, and then create that page for you. If it does not exist on catalog of life, it will try and auto-populate the hierarchy of the name that you're putting in based on what is known to the system, and give an option for the contributor to change to edit this hierarchy. If you change anything, it will ask you to revalidate this content. Again, it will check if that name exists and it will reuse that name. If If it doesn't, it will input it as a new name. So this slight complex mechanism is put in at the back end of every name that comes into the portal. So this is the interface where you can create new names. What we've also done for species pages is, so far we only had the ability to take in species or infraspecies level species pages. But now we've realized that there's a need to build pages at the higher taxon level. And so this is we've included that functionality now. Again, in its early phase, when you create species pages are contributed by experts, and experts can create higher level pages and try and populate content into these pages. This is, if for those of you who have endeavored dragonflies, you might recognize some of these images which have come out of Dr. Subbu's book on dragonflies, which he's kindly contributed to the portal. And so under each higher taxon page, the species names, the child taxa are populated automatically into the gallery, and all the content comes below, exactly like normal species pages, but with some fields maybe not relevant can be not used. Going on to observations, we found that one of the most common causes of error when people upload observations is that they get the species group wrong. And often they forget to put the species group which throws up an error, and then they have to do it again, or they put it under the wrong species group. Until now, we only had the functionality where we had to contact the end user and say, please edit this observation, this is wrong. What we thought is there are hundreds of people looking at observations, 100 people willing to correct what is wrong on the portal, and that's essentially the way crowdsourcing or crowd curation works. So what we've done is we've enabled a functionality where you can look at any observation, see if the species group is wrong, and edit that and correct it to the correct species group. Also, what we've done is we've created open tags, so you can go to any observation and click edit and add your own tag to that observation. So if you are trawling the portal searching for a particular species, maybe an invasive species, you can just put in a tag saying invasive, and you can save it. And you can come back at any point in time and say, click on the tag and bring back all these observations that you have carefully curated. So I think this will be valuable for people who are trying to aggregate content in some way. This was the default view for observations, and this was working fine as long as we had a few observations on the portal. What you have to do for every observation, if there's an unidentified observation, if you want further details, you want to put in a name for an observation, you have to click through to each thumbnail, go to the show page of that observation, put in that species name, etc. As content is growing, it is becoming more and more difficult for people to go into every observation, check every observation and put in details. So what we've done is now we've come up with a list view. Each of these observations, we put out some basic details under each observation which are essential, if you just want to scan through quickly. And we also introduce some level of interactivity, what the basic stuff that you need to do for observation. Correct a species name, you can click to suggest, it will bring down this box, you can put in the new species name, you can agree on an existing species name, you can edit the species group, etc. All these basic functions, you can check what group does the observation belong to, if not you can post it to a group, etc. All this functionality, we've put it under a list page. So now hopefully you won't have to open each observation. You can just come to the list page, which basically, right now you can access it using this icon here, the list. This is the default view, you can switch to this list view. But we're planning to make this as the default view so that people can quickly perform these actions, even validate content for us. Taxon editors, a validate button will show, we can validate that particular observation and move on. We also introduced something called custom fields, essentially as for campaigns that are run on the portal. So what this is that if you have a particular group, say you run a group on invasives, and you want to run a campaign to get people all over India to contribute invasive species information, but you are a researcher, you need certain other details. How abundant was this particular observation in that region when you took the photograph? Was it floating, was it flowering, etc. So what we've done is we've introduced custom fields where in your group you can set up these custom fields, custom questions that you want to pose to participants and try to get them to fill in this data. And every time somebody tries to upload an observation from the group, these particular fields will show and they can answer these questions. Some of these, such as this is something we did for the Trees India campaign last year. So it asks about the phenology of this tree. Does this does this tree have fruits, flowers, or fruit trees? And sometimes, because we insist on an image, image for every observation, sometimes it's pretty obvious, and sometimes the observer does not fill in these details. In the image, you can see it clearly has a fruit, it has new leaves, it has fruits. So anybody can now edit that custom field and say, I see fruits in that image, this plant has a fruit. So now we have a name and a phenological state to that. So hopefully in the future we can start aggregating this information to build some phenological data on the species. Again, this is for under the butterfly in a group. You can identify, is this particular photograph of a full-fledged adult butterfly, is it of a caterpillar, is it of a pupa, or is it an egg stage? These bits of information will again help us define maybe the life stage. We can work out some way to automate the life stage from images of the life stage from observations, etc. So again, this is a preliminary but incredibly useful on the long run. For those of you here who are developers who have interest in building apps, etc., we've released application programming interfaces for all modules on the portal. You can now use these APIs. You can get in touch with us if you need help, and basically create apps using these APIs. So what this is, it will connect with the IBP system and it will provide you, based on a query, it will provide you data on whatever it is that you need. And using this, you can build apps. And so that's what we've done recently. We've put out the Android app, which is about 6-7 months old now. Hopefully it's maturing, hopefully some of you are using it. And this has been done using the APIs. If for those of you who haven't installed it, please try it. It's available on the Play Store as India Biodiversity Portal app. Recently, this last month, we've also put out the iOS version or the Apple version for Apple devices. It's quite handy because you don't need the internet to record an observation. You can take a photograph, it will automatically detect the place name, the location of the observation, the date. You can just fill in the basic details and it will store the observation on your phone until you can get to a place with connection, and it will automatically upload it. So please try it out if you haven't. What we're currently working on is now trying to aggregate more data from external databases such as the Global Biodiversity Information Facility. We have about 120,000 observations. We take everything on the portal right now. But we try, when we incorporate data from the Global Biodiversity Information, which contains millions of data from historical and current sources, the data on IBP will grow tenfold. GBIF alone will bring around 11 to 12 lakh observations into IBP. And so what this will do is it will add so much value to distribution, to point locations in maps, in the distribution maps, and to temporal distributions in for each species. This is something we're working on. Hopefully we'll have it released within the next 2 weeks. Going on to campaigns, we've done several campaigns, just highlighting some of those. This was the Vembanad Wetland Conservation Program, where we worked with schools in the Vembanad. Vembanad is a region in Alappuzha in Kerala, where we got 8 schools to participate and try and map the local biodiversity around the schools. It ran for about a year. Good response. There was one coordinator from ATRI Vembanad, ATRI Alappuzha, working there, coordinating this event, where we go and explain what to do and maybe organize experts to come and help identify, provide training to these participants, etc. And these kids themselves would take images, upload it onto the portal, and try and build an inventory of the local region. So around 3,400 observations, the program has just concluded, but we're looking at how we can sort of continue this, upscale it to other schools in the country. We participated in Nirulu last year, where we did a taxonomy workshop on identifying trees and also highlighted the portal. Hopefully, again this year we'll be able to participate. It was actually held in NGME last year. Trees India campaign, the neighborhood trees campaign, has been running for the past 2 years. Last year again we ran this campaign. We got over 2,200 observations. This year we also had the custom fields enabled, so that we got phenological information from the trees that were uploaded. So 40% of which were flowering, 40% were also fruiting, and 52% had new leaves coming, and some combinations of those as well. Right? More information is available on the portal if you wish to know. We also ran this spotting alien invasive species or alien invasive species campaign together with Dr. Ankila from A-Tree, where we asked people to go out and spot a series of 20 invasive species and upload these invasive species onto the portal. This was slightly more complicated because you first had to know what species you were looking for. We still got around 700 observations and 98 members signing on. But maybe there's ways that we can do this better and get more participation later. We need to explore these possibilities. We've also started something called the Northeast India Biodiversity Portal, or a group on the portal for Northeast India. We launched this portal on 23rd and 24th September last year in the Northeast Hill University, where we got around 45 participants from across the Northeast to come in and participate and expose the portal and show them how to use the portal. We did a small exercise of traveling around, recording observations, etc. And it's good because there's not much exposure to the portal in the Northeast. And there's a very good response, and people asked that you please come back to specific regions and do more exercises, because the portal is not known in these areas and there's so much potential and it could be very useful for these people. So now A3 has funded the Northeast program. Rohit is working in the Northeast right now, doing these campaigns, going traveling across the Northeast, trying to raise awareness on the portal. Some of these events have already happened. There are more scheduled for later. If you know somebody in the Northeast who would like a workshop organized, please get in touch with us. We'll try and help make that possible. The India Moths group has been running the National Moth Week every year. This is the second year we ran it. This is incredible because it brought in so much data onto the portal on moths. Essentially, about 20% of the data is on moths. And sometimes we say the portal is moth-ridden because there's so much moth data on the portal. So again, good participation last year. We'll be repeating it again this year. The Frogwatch group, Dr. Gururaja has been very active in identifying all frogs that come into the portal. There's some participants here, Vineet, Karthik, etc., who come in regularly identifying frogs. And we ran this campaign to map the distribution of the Malabar tree toad. This is essentially an arboreal tree toad, which lives on, which is mostly seen on trees, but it's only seen around the monsoons. So we wanted to try and see if people knew about the existence of this species. Is it seen outside the monsoon period? What other habitats are seen? We got around 15-20, I'd say more than that, observations of this species. And what we want to try and do with the Frogwatch group is maybe do a rolling exercise where every month, every week, we have a new species and get people to upload sightings of this particular species. The Wembanad Fish Count, we have been a data partner for the Wembanad Fish Count. It happens every year where 15 to 20 participants go to Wembanad Lake, go out in 3 to 4 boats, sample the location, record what are the species seen, and put up this data. And we will be trying to aggregate that data onto IBP. Hopefully next year again we'll be doing this. Now, we've been partnering with the Damselfly India, Dragonfly India group. We participated in the Dragonfly India conference meet 2 years back as well as last year. Last year it was held in Vattakaven. Again, we went and exposed IBP to the participants. Good response from Dragonfly observers, and there's good participation with good rate of identification in dragonflies. Now, contented participation. We're finding that participation is growing rapidly, especially in the last few years, couple of years. These are just a map of observations that have come in with a temporal time scale animation. Around 64,000 observations with images right now, and content is rapidly building on the portal. If you try and look at which are the states that are most active, you can see Karnataka most active, followed by Kerala. Kerala, which has been dropping in the recent years, so you can see the years are the colors of the years on top. Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Assam, Meghalaya. Recently, after we started the Northeast India Biodiversity Initiative, West Bengal, Pondicherry, etc. Some states where we have very little information, simply Orissa. Andaman has been growing recently. Tripura, Jharkhand, Punjab, Chhattisgarh, all these regions, we actually have very little information. These are some areas that we need to concentrate on, try and get somebody to raise awareness on the portal, try and get people to participate. I think it will happen, but as digital India moves forward, as the internet penetrates these regions, as more awareness is created, all these will happen. But some of the areas that we need to focus on. In species pages, we have 20,000 species pages with some content, 28,000 species pages which are just stubs with very skeletal content, 6,000 species pages with images, 6,500, and at least 11,000 species pages which have at least one observation put under it, that is one record in the occurrence map. We have around 103 people who have signed up as species page contributors to try and populate these species pages. We need to have much more active. These species page contributors also double up as content curators validating observations. We need to try and make some progress on this front to incorporate more experts, so-called experts, onto the portal. User registrations have been growing exponentially mostly in the last 1 year or so. Around 7,600 users signed up right now. And that's a good sign, because the internet says that 1% of your registered users will be active contributors. We're finding it's much more than that for IBP. And so hopefully as this grows, content and participation will increase even further. This is the map showing the distribution of observations. You can see these regions which are intensely populated, Western Ghats and the Northeast, which have good amount of content. Some regions which have very poor content, essentially north, west of India, and central, eastern part of the country. But who are these people who are uploading these observations? If you just take the top 30 users and try and map out the observations, we just color coded it, you can see there's some sort of patterns are emerging. You don't know what exactly, but because so many points are there together. But you can see there's some concentrations of these points in certain regions. So if you try and sort of tease that apart and see who are these people who have been uploading. So I've just taken the top 10 users and tried to see where are they focusing on, where are their observations coming from. This is Anoop. Anoop is an IT professional who is also a photographer, keeps traveling to take observation. Essentially around the Bangalore region and Kolhapur, where his house is, he goes and he's been providing lots of information on biodiversity from these regions. Dr. Rujita, who is an MD in anesthetology, who works in the Kaas Plateau, incredible documenter. Every few months, he goes out there, meticulously documents these, documents observations, gets them verified, and gets in touch with us to get some help in uploading these observations. And all these observations from around this Kaas Plateau, she's been putting in. Satish Nikam, who is essentially a Flickr user, but every time he uploads to Flickr, he also ensures that the content comes into IBP. And he's been at it for the past few years. Every week he'll come and upload his backlog of observations onto IBP. And essentially around the Lonavala region in Pune. Vinay Raj, who is also a Wikipedia contributor, incredible documentation around Peravur, Kerala, which is near Kannur. Siddharth, who works at NCBS, identifies a lot of observations, contributes from around the Bangalore region, also a lot of observations coming in from Sakleshpur, Karnataka, where his house is. Dharni is here somewhere. Dharni has been traveling, is based in Pondicherry, but I guess he's also been traveling across. Somebody told me recently he's also a biker, so I guess he's biking around the country and recording observations across, but mostly from Pondicherry he's concentrating. Nagabhushan here? So, there. Nagabhushan, based out of Malimbanur, Karnataka, which is slightly north here. And I'd never heard of the region until Nagabhushan started uploading observations. So incredible amount of content for that region coming in from Nagabhushan. And Dr. Vijay Anand, who is based in Assam, he's a medical doctor that runs a hospital there. But every his passion is also wildlife photography. He had a heart attack. He was advised to take regular walks. And during these walks, he sort of started taking his camera along and discovered the world of wildlife and photography. Incredible amount of contributions coming from that particular region. It's never documented, never on a map before. All these people, essentially what they're doing is, by contributing this observation, they're essentially placing a locality, the biodiversity of a locality, onto the observation, onto the reference map of India, in terms of biodiversity records. Satya Narayan thinks, so unfortunately he's not been contributing lately. He got married and the observation stopped. so be careful. But yeah, incredible amount of observation coming in from this region called Martimuli in Andhra Pradesh. Again, so focusing on certain regions and ensuring that the biodiversity of that region gets documented. But there are some exceptions. Look at this. Chief Red Earth, as we knew him initially, we met him finally last year at the community meet. And he's been traveling across the country. I've just tried to animate this and see how is this, his observation been. You can see, initially he's been focusing down south in Trivandrum where he's based. But he seems to be traveling across India and he's reached the central part of India now. Hopefully, he's going to cover the rest of India. Maybe it's what he's already need, you know, to get observations on the portal. An incredible fellow, over 4,000 observations on the portal right now. But only these observations alone will not help. You know, it has to be identified, it has to be curated, looked at. And who are these people? So these are some of our top species identified every time observations come in. Some of them don't even upload a single observation, but they will regularly come in every week, every day, identify observations. You can see Ravi Vaidyanathan in 2000. Luvan Chaturanga, who is not even an Indian, he is from Sri Lanka. S. Kasam, Siddharth, Dr. Gururaja, Vijay Bhave, Hari is here. Satyanarayan Srinivasan, Muthukarthik, who works with Karath, Joby Paul, Arun, Dr. Roger Kendrick, Ramakrishna Singh Rathod, who is based in Delhi, Arun Mudista, Dr. Mohanan, who is with TBGRI, Siddharth Kulkarni, who is a resident expert on spiders, Pankaj, who will hear later today, presenting on Aldonates, Devyani, Mike, who identified moths, and Sina is also from America, who works on dung beetles there. So these are the people who add value to these observations and put a name to observations and ensure that, you know, things are curated on the portal. So what have these people been identifying? In 2012, most common identification, top 10 most common identifications. Very few in 2012 because we started quite late in the year and there was very little participation that time. But essentially the most common was axis, spotted deer. The Calotus versicolor, which is the garden lizard, has occupied top spot. And that's still occupying top spot now. A few birds, one butterfly. In 2013, that sort of moved on. Now we're beginning to get more arthropods coming in. People are beginning to identify arthropods. The elephant has come into the picture. Again, somewhere down there, the garden lizard is still holding its position in the top 10. More content is coming in. Now we have around 14,000 species names being put, unique species names being put to observations. In 2014, what we did is we ran these two campaigns, the Trees India campaign and the moths campaign. And as a result of which, the top species identified were moths. And you can see that the trees have started making an appearance in the top most identified observations. But essentially, it's just taken over by moths and trees. And finally, in 2015, again, Calotus versicolor has taken top spot. I would suspect it's because of the environment of Hari has been identifying these and correcting identifications. Lantana camera, which is the common lantana, has occupied second spot because we ran this, the spotting alien invasives campaign. We've gotten a lot of lantana into this. But rest of it, now these biases are sort of evening out because there's much more participation now. People are sort of uploading varied content onto the portal. And so we did this exercise to see how are people using this data. And we just looked up Google Scholar and to check what publications have come out as a result of IBP data, and we noticed that there were around 30 papers that cited IBP. And most of this is from species pages or map layers, but we think observation information is going to increase as we go along. Most of these are peer-reviewed journal publications, some other books and reports, etc. I need to highlight these two publications essentially because both of these publications were spider records, one by Sunny Joseph and one from the VNC group in Gujarat, who first put their records on IBP, and it was spotted by an expert who got in touch with them, verified the identity, and published these as new records for India from IBP, of course. This is both with the help of Siddharth Kulkarni. We also participated in the taxonomic database working group, because what we are doing is not just some haphazard way of organizing data. We do it along certain international standards, and we constantly need to keep abreast of these changes in information standards. So we make it a point, if we can afford it, to go to this taxonomic database working group every year and keep ourselves updated with what is happening in the world of biodiversity informatics. We presented 4 papers on various aspects of the India Awareness Portal. Hopefully next year also we will be able to go. That's it from me. Thank you.